Kerr, and I will be your lector for this Mass. Our celebrant will be Father Leon, assisted by Deacon Paul. All gifts and gift cards for the Giving Tree are due to be returned to the vestibule by next Sunday, December 10th, with the tags attached. Thank you for your support. This Friday, December 8th, is the Feast of the Immaculate Conception, which is a holy day of obligation. Directly after will be the Respect Life National Night of Prayer. Please see the details in the bulletin. Please read the bulletin for important information on the Advent Night of Reconciliation, the Advent Penance Service, and the Kids Advent Social, and much more. Readings for today's liturgy are located at 1091 in the Gathering Book. At this time, I ask you to stand and welcome those around you.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, Father.
As we begin today, I invite you all to please be seated for just a moment. Today we celebrate the rite of acceptance. We are very blessed that we have 14 in total among us who are preparing to be brought into the Catholic Church at the Easter Vigil, some by way of baptism and some by way of converting to Catholicism. And we begin this formal process today with the rite of acceptance. And so I ask Dr. Peer now to lead us for a few moments.
I ask our RCIA candidates, catechumens, and their sponsors to please come forward in front of the altar and face the congregation. Today we are filled with great joy as we celebrate the first of three rites within the rite of Christian initiation of adults and children. Today we will all take part in the rite of acceptance into the order of catechumens for our unbaptized brothers and sisters, and the rite of welcoming for the candidates, our brothers and sisters, who are seeking to complete their Christian initiation through the sacraments of Confirmation and Eucharist. These brothers and sisters have been coming weekly since September as inquirers and have been meeting with members of our parish RCIA team to understand more fully their call to be Catholic or to become fully accepted into our church. As we begin Mass, we would like to invite these catechumens and candidates to join us and to take the next step in their faith journey. Our celebrant will welcome our brothers and sisters and into this church community at St. Gregory the Great and our parish family.
My dear brothers and sisters, on behalf of the Church of St. Gregory, I welcome you this afternoon as catechumens and candidates, taking this initial but very important step toward your full acceptance into the Catholic Church. You are here today because the Spirit has spoken to you, and you have chosen to listen to God's call. You and your sponsors will begin this faith journey that will lead to full initiation in the Church, completion of this journey that began with your baptism and will now continue as you prepare for sacraments of confirmation and Eucharist. And so, individually, I ask you now, what is your name?
Ariel Clark.
Corey Steimel.
Michael Thompson.
Isabel Engelman.
Sarah Kerr.
Peter Rosikoff.
Cassandra Sahina.
Rich Haskins.
Miranda Blinsler.
Austin Buffon.
And collectively now to answer, what do you ask of God's Church? And what does faith offer you? So you got the first two answers right, along with your name, so three answers. That's great. God gives light to everyone who comes into the world. Though unseen, he reveals himself through the works of his hand, so that all people may learn to give thanks to their Creator. You will follow God's light. The way of the gospel now lies open before you. Set your feet firmly on that path and acknowledge the living God who truly speaks to everyone. Walk in the light of Christ and learn to trust in his wisdom. Commit your lives daily to his care so that you may come to believe in him with all of your heart. This is the way of faith along which Christ will lead you in love toward eternal life. I ask you, collectively, are you prepared to begin this journey today under the guidance of Christ? And for our sponsors present, sponsors, you present these catechumens and candidates to us. Are you and all who are gathered here with us ready to help all of these catechumens and candidates find and follow Christ? Before you answer, not only for our sponsors, but all of us, I'll give you a hint, the answer is we are. Are you ready to do this?
We are.
Excellent. Father of mercy, we thank you for these, your servants. You have sought and summoned them in many ways, and they have turned to seek you. You have called them today, and they have answered in our presence. We praise you, Lord, and we bless you. Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to return back to your place, and I invite us all to stand as we begin the Mass. We begin our prayer together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And may the grace and peace of God our Father, the love of our Lord Jesus Christ, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And with your spirit.
To prepare ourselves to come to the altar worthily, we once again pause to acknowledge our sins so we may faithfully enter the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, and what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
Kyrie eleison.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us of our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Grant your faithful, we pray, Almighty God, the resolve to run forth to meet your Christ with righteous deeds at his coming, so that gathered at his right hand they may be worthy to possess the heavenly kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. You, Lord, are our Father, our Redeemer. You are named forever. Why do you let us wander, O Lord, from your ways, and harden our hearts so that we fear you not? Return for the sake of your servants, the tribes of your heritage. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down with the mountains, quaking before you. While you wrought awesome deeds, we could not hope for such as they had not heard of from of old. No ear has ever heard, no eye ever seen, any God but you doing such deeds for those who wait for him. Would you might meet us doing right, that we were mindful of you and in our ways? Behold, you are angry and we are sinful. All of us have become like unclean people. All our good deeds are like polluted rags. We have all withered like leaves, and our guilt carries us away like the wind. There is none who calls upon your name, who rouses himself to cling to you, for you are hidden your face from us, and you have delivered us up to our guilt. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are the potter. We are all the work of your hands. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Make us turn to you, let us see your face, and we shall be saved. Lord, make us turn to you, let us see your face, and we shall be saved. O Shepherd of Israel, hear us. Enthroned on the cherubim, shine forth. Rouse up your might and come to save us. Lord, make us turn to you. Let us see your face and shall be saved. God of hosts, turn again, we implore. Look down from heaven and see. Visit this vine and protect it, the stock your right hand has planted, the son you have claimed for yourself. Lord, make us turn to you. Let us see your face, and we shall be saved. May your hand be on the man at your right hand, the Son of Man you have confirmed as your own. And we shall never forsake you again. Give us life that we may call upon your name. us turn to you. Let us see your face, and we shall be saved.
Second reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always on your account for the grace of God bestowed on you in Jesus Christ, that in him you were enriched in every way, with all discourse and all knowledge, as the testimony to Christ was confirmed among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will keep you firm to the end, irreproachable on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, and by him you were called to fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Be watchful, be alert. You do not know when the time will come. It is like a man traveling abroad. He leaves home and places his servants in charge, each with his own work, and orders the gatekeeper to be on the watch. Watch, therefore, you do not know when the Lord of the house is coming, whether in the evening or at midnight or at cockcrow or in the morning. May he not come suddenly and find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to all. Watch." The Gospel of the Lord.
Well, you're all in trouble today. You're in trouble because Advent does not have the Gloria sung, which saves a few minutes. And the gospel was really short, and now it's the homily. You're in trouble. If you think for a moment about the culture that we live in and really the culture that forms us externally, as a culture, I'm going to guess that you will agree with me that patience is not one of our strong suits. And generally, we're not so good when it comes to waiting for things. Externally, we're really kind of conditioned in our culture for things to be very quick and very much on demand. For example, we use microwaves Why? The food will get hot quicker and we can eat faster. That's why. And will you go to the ATM? Why? Because I can do my banking 24/7. I don't need to see somebody inside the bank anymore. We have movies on demand available at any time. We have push notifications and various forms of communication so we can make information available. We can have express checkout and also overnight delivery from almost anywhere in the world to where we live. And we have fast food. Now, the last time I stopped at one of such places for the drive-thru, it took longer than eating at a five-star restaurant. But nonetheless, we still call it fast food. Quick. I will not even bring up what happens if traffic is going at or below the speed limit, what that does to our blood pressure. I don't have to bring that up. All these external things really are a sign of our lack of patience, and we want things now. We don't want to wait. But really, it's nothing only external. It's also something internal. Internally, from a very young age, we're really trained probably to not wait. If you think for a moment, when we're little children, we can't wait till we get old enough to go to school with our older brothers and sisters. And once we're in school, we can't wait to make friends. And once we make friends, we can't wait till we start playing sports with them and having other activities. And once that is settled and we get a little older, we can't wait till we make our first penance in second grade. And once we do that, we can't wait till we make our first Holy Communion in third grade. Once we accomplish that, we can't wait till we get to middle school. And once we get to junior high, we can't really wait till we get to eighth grade, because in eighth grade, we rule the school. And once we're in eighth grade ruling the school, we can't wait till we get to high school. And once we get to high school, we really can't wait till we get confirmed. And once we're confirmed, we can't wait till we get a part-time job so we can start earning a little money. And once we start having a little money, we can't wait till we turn 16 so we can get our driver's license. And once we're 16, we can't wait till we get a car. And once we have our car, then of course we can't wait till we're a senior in high school. And once we're a senior in high school, we can't wait till we graduate and get to college. And once we get to college soon thereafter, we can't wait until we graduate from college and perhaps graduate school. And then we can't wait till we get that first real job that pays real money, because we can't wait to get out on our own and get our own apartment. Once we get our own apartment, we can't wait till we get married. Once we get married, we can't wait till we buy our first home. And once we buy our first home, we can't wait until we have children. And once we have children, we can't wait for them to start school. And we can't wait for them to make friends and start playing sports. We can't wait for them to make their first penance or their first Holy Communion. We can't wait for them to get into junior high. And then we can't wait for them to get to eighth grade and graduate. And once they graduate from eighth grade, we can't wait for them to start high school. And once in high school, parents really can't wait for their kids to be confirmed. And once they're confirmed, they can't wait for their kids to start getting a part-time job, to learn some responsibility, to earn some money. And once they are doing that, they can't wait for them to turn 16 so the kids can get their driver's license and their own car and start driving themselves places. However, we can wait for the impact on the insurance bill of that entire thing. We can wait for that. We don't like that one. But then we can't wait for our kids to graduate from high school. We can't wait for them to start college. We can't wait for them to graduate college. Certainly, we cannot wait for them to get that real job and move out on their own and get that first apartment. And then we can't wait for them to settle down and get married. And once they're married, we can't wait for them to get our house. And once they get their house, we can't wait for them to have children, because now we have grandchildren. And once we have grandchildren, we can't wait for our children and grandchildren to come to visit. And once they come to visit, we can't wait for them to go home. Kind of the routine of life. Internally, we can't wait. Externally, we cannot wait. Why do I bring all that up with great excitement? What are we told to do in the readings? Wait. And what do we do as we wait? Watch. We're called to wait and to watch. St. Paul, in that letter to the Corinthians, recognized impatience and human longing, and he reminded the Corinthians, reminds us, encourages the Corinthians, encourages us to do what? Be patient. As you wait for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep firm to the end, because God is faithful. What should give us consolation as we wait? St. Paul answers that question. We have all discourse, all knowledge, every spiritual gift given to us by Jesus Christ. We're to take consolation that we have all discourse, all knowledge provided by the Lord, and many gifts and talents to be good stewards for the Lord Jesus. We have the power of the Holy Spirit to lead us in the life of holiness and the sacraments. And so wonderful we have our candidates and catechumens at this Mass who are, as adults, approaching the sacraments, looking for that grace, looking for the power of the Holy Spirit to come to them to live the life of faith in and through the sacraments of the Church. And we take this all to the Gospel, and the Gospel really does not tell us, if you noticed, does not tell us the exact date and time that the Lord is coming. We do not have a date and time. We don't have personally the date and time that the Lord will come individually for our individual judgment, and corporately the end of time, the end of the world, when the living and the dead will be judged corporately. We do not have a date and time. Why? Why? If Jesus told us all this is going to happen, why didn't he tell us when it was going to happen? Well, I think he didn't tell us when it was going to happen because it would make us sluggish. It would probably also lead us into a life of sin, because if we knew the date and time, we could do whatever we wanted until the day before and then go to confession and we'd be all fine. You know, it would make us probably not striving for holiness. So what are we to do? What are we to do with our lives, especially what does Advent call us to do? To always be ready. We are always to be patient, especially with the Lord. We are not patient with one another, but often we're not patient with the Lord either. We will very clearly tell the Lord, this is what I need you to do on this time frame. You know, we're not patient. We need to be vigilant. As we heard in the gospel, as the servants waiting, vigilant, we're always to be prepared. We're to enter into the battle between living the life of the light of the gospel in the midst of a world that often has darkness of sin. We're to cultivate an attitude of anticipation, not an attitude of I can't wait, not an attitude of impatience, but anticipation, excitement, a joy over the coming of the Lord. We need to see ourselves really as servants of the Lord, as the gospel indicates. The servants were entrusted to keep doing their duties until the unknown day and time the master returned. So in so doing, we need to fulfill our duties, to use our time, our talent, our treasure to serve the gospel. We're to speak of Christ to all who will listen. And so often we find that hard. We don't want to ruffle any feathers or get anybody upset. So we don't speak the truth of the gospel when we have many opportunities to do so. Yet we're called to be that disciple who speaks the truth of the gospel. We're called to live a lifestyle of prayer, a life of modesty, a life of self-denial. And in the busyness of these things, we grow in that anticipation, a longing for the joy of the unknown day and hour that the Lord will call us to stand before him. We look with longing for that. That's what Advent's about. Advent is not about getting the cards written and the gifts purchased and wrapped. It's not about all of the baking and the food and the decorations. These things are important and they're good, and I do them too. But if that's what these weeks come for us, and somehow we're not growing in an anticipation to meet the Lord, well, then we've failed in the season of Advent. We pray for that grace to really enter into this season wisely. We have a couple things we will do before we profess our faith, and the first is going to be to bless our Advent wreath. Lord God, your church joyfully awaits the coming of its Savior, who enlightens our hearts and dispels the darkness of ignorance and sin. Pour forth your blessings upon us as we light the candles of this wreath. May their light reflect the splendor of Christ, who is Lord forever and ever. Amen. At this time, I invite our candidates and catechumens to come forward once again before the altar, along with your sponsors. Now this time, I'm going to switch it up. I need the sponsors to be in front of their candidate or catechumen. My dear candidates and catechumens, your answers that you gave at the very beginning of Mass, before you entered the church, meant that you wished to share in the faith and the hope of Christ, to admit you as candidates and catechumens. I now mark you with the sign of Christ's cross, and I call that your catechists and sponsors will now also do the same. I invite our sponsors to trace the sign of the cross on the forehead of your candidate or catechumen. Receive the cross on your forehead. It is Christ himself who now strengthens you with this sign of love. Learn to know him and to follow him. Receive the sign of the cross on your ears, that you may hear the voice of the Lord. Glory and praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Receive the sign of the cross on your eyes, that you may see the glory of God. Receive the sign of the cross on your lips, that you may respond to the word of the Lord.
Glory and praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Receive the sign of the cross over your heart, that Christ may dwell there by faith. Receive the sign of the cross on your shoulders, that you may bear the gentle yoke of Christ.
Glory and praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Receive the sign of the cross on your hands, that Christ may be known in the work in which you do. Receive the sign of the cross on your feet, that you may walk in the way of Christ.
Glory
Almighty God, by the cross and resurrection of your Son, you have given life to your people. Your servants have received the sign of the cross. Make them living proof of its saving power and help them to persevere in the footsteps of Christ. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Each of our candidates and catechumens will receive a Bible, a book of the sacred scripture, as they prepare and study the word of the Lord. And so we pray our Lord's blessing upon these Bibles. Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing upon these Bibles, these books containing your spoken word to us. As our candidates and catechumens use them in prayer and reflection, illumine their mind, their heart, and their soul so that the Easter sacraments may take firm root in them and they grow in an abundant love for you. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. May Almighty God bless these books for their use, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. My dear candidates and catechumens, before we dismiss you to go and break open the Word of God, I say we offer them a word of encouragement. Oh, not yet, Nancy. One moment. I don't know what news stations people watch, but, you know, Channel 4 did a segment on the church this week, and one of the many comments that were made was, what young person would want to become part of the church at this time? 14 people, not here, but 14 people in a very difficult chapter of history in the Diocese of Buffalo and in the church, and it's not just the Catholic Church, every denomination of every belief is going through the same thing we are. They are. I talk to them at ecumenical meetings. And to have 14 people come forward at this difficult time, this is the light in the midst of the darkness. So please pray for them, because it is wonderful to have you come forward at this moment in time. And know of our love, our prayer. Lord, we ask you to pour forth the power of your Spirit upon our brothers and sisters as they go forward now to break open your word. May they meditate intensely upon it. Guide and direct them to the Easter sacraments now and always through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Now Nancy's on. Together now we profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and a life of the world to come. Amen. Heavenly Father, witnessing your presence and action in our very midst, the light in the midst of darkness, as we wait and watch, we humbly ask you, please hear our needs and petitions and help us on our way.
For the church, may it effectively prepare the world for the coming of Jesus and for the peace that his coming brings. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For leaders of all nations, may they be given the gift of peace, so peace may flourish and wars may end. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
As we look to the birth of our Savior, may many be called to follow in his footsteps and minister to his flock. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor and sick, especially those suffering from chronic ailments, may they face their trials with faith in Jesus, their divine healer. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish community, may those who feel lonely and ignored be blessed with loving companions and good neighbors. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Salvatore Joseph Spano, who is being baptized today, may God bless him, his parents, godparents, and family through the sacrament. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intention of this Mass, whom we pray for in a special way. Angelo, Argentino, Antonia and Dorothy, Leon and Carmen de Oliveira. And for our own prayers and intentions, which we offer now in prayerful silence. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who have died in faith, may they be granted the rewards and blessings of the kingdom, especially those who have passed on this week from our parish and faith community. Joseph D. Weldon, Sr., Camille Ruda, and Mary Sushan, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we offer you these, our many needs, spoken and treasured in the heart. Humbly we pray, please hear us and help us through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our ushers will now take up the collection offered by the Violante family.
Despite the rage of foes, more brighter than that glorious morn.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Accept, we pray, O Lord, these offerings we make, gathered from among your gifts to us. And may what you grant us to celebrate devoutly here below gain for us the prize of eternal redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he assumed at his first coming the lowliness of human flesh, and so fulfilled the design you formed long ago, and open for us the way to eternal salvation, that when he comes again in glory and majesty and all is at last made manifest, we who watch for that day may inherit the great promise in which we now dare to hope. And so with angels, archangels, thrones, and dominions, and with all of the hosts and the powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness, make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. The time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Michael, our bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed Apostle, St. Gregory the Great, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus
Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command and formed by divine teaching as we now dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sin, but on the faith of your church, graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Now let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Gave the guilt of your people and covered all their sins. You averted all your rage. You turned back the heat of your anger. The Lord will bestow his loving kindness, and our land will yield its fruit.
Thank you.
Before we conclude, just a few reminders. First of all, tomorrow is the Advent Night of Recollection at 7 o'clock in the evening here in church. And Father Luke Klein, who is the chaplain of St. Joseph's Hospital, he will be our speaker. He's a very dynamic speaker. I think you'll enjoy him. And he probably will tell you many stories about me that are not true. So do come. He is a very, very captivating individual. And a good way to start off Advent for the Night of Recollection at 7 o'clock here in church. Also, the Advent Penance Service will be for the whole family, for all of our three parishes. Will be on Monday, December 11th, a week from tomorrow. And there'll be two opportunities, one at 3 in the afternoon, and that'll be held at St. Pius X Church, and then one again at St. Greg's here at 7 p.m. And that is next week, Monday the 11th. And a reminder that this Friday is a holy day, calling us to come to Mass, the Immaculate Conception. All of the Masses for all three of our parishes are printed in the bulletin, so we invite you to take that home with you. Let us pray. May these mysteries, O Lord, in which we have participated, profit us, we pray. For even now as we walk amid passing things, you teach us by them to love the things of heaven and hold fast to what endures. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Let us go in peace, glorifying the Lord by our lives.
Thanks be to God. In every age, O God, you have called us to be your people, to be your church. In this time, we begin anew to discern the pathways that will lead us, your people, closer to you. Continually bless our journey as we proclaim your good news, celebrate your saving presence among us, serve others with charity and justice, and steward the world you've entrusted to our care. Send your Spirit to lead and guide our Emmaus journey as we commit ourselves to the renewal of our church. This we ask through Christ our Lord. Amen.